I've got a love-hate relationship with variable NDs. They are my most used filter on mirrorless cameras, as they are absolutely essential to precisely control the amount of light coming in so I can get the exact depth of field, ISO, and shutter speed that I need. Good quality fixed NDs tend to be superior, but are only really practical when you are in controlled lighting. I don't need to use any variable NDs when I'm shooting with my Sony FX6 though, because it has an electronic variable ND over the sensor. But for my mirrorless cameras, I use variable NDs. And that's where we run into problems, because they aren't ND filters, but two polarisers. This is the Freewell K2 magnetic filter system, which is essentially a more advanced version of their excellent magnetic variable ND system that I've been using for close to 2 years, and there's several key differences between them. The most obvious one looking at it is its ability to use their drop-in filters by flipping open these doors at the top and bottom. You only need the bottom one when you're using graduated NDs, so you can change the position. I will talk more about this later, as I want to address K2's single biggest attraction for me first, and that's the color shift, which is so slight that when I was editing this video, I couldn't tell if the shots were with it on or off. Now, this video is sponsored by Freewell, but I really do these because I have to not just like the product, but test it to death, because sponsored videos are endorsements. I don't take that lightly. So for this video to be of actual value to you, I've compared the K2 to numerous other variable NDs. Little did I know just how frustrating and difficult it is to compare them. It's not just a case of putting them on a lens and looking at the results, as there are so many variables that can affect them. I redid my tests at least a dozen times, probably way more than that, to be confident in my conclusions. This was a steep learning curve for me, so some was guesswork. Although, if I've gotten anything correct, I'm sure you'll let me know in the comments. My endless tests actually started back in 2020 at my favourite place on earth, Eleni Beach in Skiathos, Greece. Although since I adopted beautiful 15-year-old Severus here last year, it's going to feel really different when I go back, as she's always been there. But it's better now because she's safe. You can buy some pretty cheap variable NDs, but of course you get what you pay for. But what I found surprising in my endless tests was that the more money you spent didn't guarantee better all-round quality. These tests were before Freewell's K2 system, of course, but I had their original split-strength variable NDs here, alongside many others. I didn't finish the video for several reasons, story of my YouTube life, but now I can finally use the footage. I was testing the colour and the sharpness mainly. The sharpness test was the most straightforward, and I was really impressed at how well many of them maintained the sharpness. Not all of them though, but it's hard not to notice how drastically different the colours were. There's two main reasons for this that I didn't fully understand at the time. The changing position of the sun was a huge factor, clearly, as was the changing of the strength of them. But not for the reasons that you might think. I couldn't understand why in certain shots increasing the strength made the colour shift worse, and in other shots it improved it. After making this video, I now finally fully understand these misunderstood filters. Hopefully after watching this, you will too. Polarisers are used to cut the amount of reflected light. They can reduce reflections and glare at certain angles, increasing saturation and contrast. There's two types of polarisers, linear and circular. Both do the same thing, but you must avoid linear if you use a camera like a DSLR because of cross-polarisation with its mirror. This can screw up your metering and also affect your autofocus. It all depends on the subject and angle. This doesn't affect the camera when it's in live view mode, only when using the mirror. Circular polarisers are linear polarisers with a second optical element at the rear called a quarter wave plate that spins the polarised light so it doesn't interfere with the camera's mirror. They only work in one orientation, not something you will mistake when using screw-on ones, but for matte boxes you might. Linear polarisers work facing either direction.
If you're not sure which type of polariser you have, for example, it's not written on it, or maybe you can't read, then there's a couple of ways to find out. The most fun way is to hold it in front of a mirror and then look through it. But because they need to show it to you on the camera, it's a bit awkward because of this way you'll see it is a big black lens camera. Anyway, I'm just going to switch to the iPhone to show you. It might look as pretty, but the point is you can see the difference.
Variable NDs use different combinations of linear and circular polarizers. It's a little bit more complicated than that, but at its core, this is what they are. Most of mine are dual circular polarizers. I've got just one that is circular and linear, but interestingly, during the making of this video, I found out that I've got quite a lot of dual linear ones. This is what the K2 has, but having dual linear is no guarantee of quality. The worst filter in my test is also dual linear, and it's the cheapest. What has really surprised me is just how hard it is to find out what type of polarizers manufacturers are using, as they generally don't say what they are. The easiest way is the good old mirror test. Dual linear show as clear on both sides, and dual circular show as dark on both sides. Circular and linear combination ones are clear one way round and dark the other. So if you have no idea what your variable ND is, then unless you're a vampire, I'm sure you've got a mirror in your house somewhere. Take your variable ND, hold it up, and look through. Manufacturers really need to state what they are using, as it makes a big difference in how they behave. There's no right way, they're just different. This is a circular polarizer, the correct way round. If I put another one in front of it, then I get a color shift from warm to cool. Flip it the other way round, and now we have a variable ND. When you stack two linear polarizers, they will work as a variable ND in either direction. Variable NDs using two circular polarizers do not work as polarizers. They can only be used to cut the amount of light coming in. But the problem is this combination can cause color balance shift issues. The main reason is two circular polarizers, which already have a color shift individually. When doubled up and orientated to use a variable ND, they have an added color temperature shift. But sometimes you won't see any change. Whilst dual CPL VNDs don't work as polarizers, the angle of light is still the primary cause of the color temperature shift. Polarizers have the most effect when you are 90 degrees to the light source, for example, the sun. They don't do anything if you point towards it or directly opposite. With dual linear or linear circular combination of variable NDs, they do polarize the light. The color shift we're seeing here is down to the saturation and contrast changes from polarization. Pointing the camera towards the sun, you can see the base color shift of these various variable ND filters. And it doesn't matter if I increase or decrease the strength, the color shift is pretty consistent. And it's the same if I rotate the camera or the filter itself. I also did a more scientific test using a color chart with the light source bounced behind the camera. The downside to having a variable ND that polarizes light is you may not want that. This is the downside of the linear circular combination ones that simply screw onto the lens. The strength and polarization are tied together. You cannot isolate them. The only way to adjust the polarization with them is to loosen them from the thread and rotate them. A rather risky thing to do. Freewell's K2 uses a quick-release base that fits onto a ring that you attach to your lens. It comes with sizes from 67 to 82 millimeters, and it's Loctite using these red screws. But when you loosen them, it allows you to rotate the whole variable ND filter to change the polarization without affecting the ND strength that you've set it to. Using dual linear polarizers has made it possible for Freewell to use special polarizing film that avoids that color shift. If you are using DSLRs to take photos in 2023, should you avoid the K2 due to the dual linear polarizer potential issue? Using any NDs, let alone variable ones, when shooting with the mirror are not good anyway. Whilst they help you cut the light coming in, they darken the viewfinder. It's like putting on dark glasses, which get much darker. If you're using them for live view use, you know, for landscapes or other photos, and of course video, no problem whatsoever. To be honest, you really should be using a mirrorless by now. Filming different types of screens can be challenging with some variable NDs. I was unable to film my iPhone with any dual CPL variable ND, no matter the strength or angle. With the other types you can, but unless you can physically rotate the filter like the K2, then you are limited to just the strength of the ND or loosen it from the filter thread. Other types of screens behave differently. The dual CPLs gave off a very heavy color shift with my MacBook Pro and a lesser one with my OLED TV, depending on the angle and strength. Again, the ability to rotate the filter is key to getting it to look as natural as possible. The K2 was able to easily get the most accurate looking colors due to them being dual linear with that special film and that ability to rotate the filter so you can get the polarizers to line up with the light emitted from the screen. You can see just how problematic screw-on variable ND filters can be at times. Without an ability to rotate them, you won't always be able to get the best out of them. You need to be realistic about how much light your variable ND can cut. If you try and push it too far, your color will be affected and you'll get the dreaded cross pattern. That's when the polarizers have reached their maximum point and start going the other way. And this is why most high quality VNDs split their ranges across two filters, for example 2-5 stops and 6-9 stops. The stronger strength is achieved by having a 4-5 stop proper ND reduction built into it. The K2's first filter is impressively 1-5 stops. They were able to do this because of the use of dual linear polarizers. They tell me it wasn't possible if they used a circular polarizer. What I love about the K2 system and their magnetic variable ND system before it is their modular design. The K2 has a linear base and the magnetic VND system has a circular polarizer base. Then you have the front filters that you magnetically snap on. Again, the K2 is linear, as I've already explained, and the old system is circular. They both need to be the correct way round, even the linear one, because it gives you the hard stops as it clicks into place. You'll know which is which as they are marked. When they're the other way round, they're designed to be used as just polarizers. To use them as polarizers, you do need to remove that first base filter first. If you don't, then with the magnetic system, you get that same color change I showed you if you've got two CPL screwed onto your lens. With the K2, you'll get a variable ND without hard stops, which isn't recommended because you won't get the best results past the safe area. When using dual CPL variable NDs, it's impossible to add a polarizer without adding that extreme color balance shift you get when you have two circular polarizers facing in the same direction, which is a big negative for these types. I don't know why Freewell isn't making more of this, as you can polarize light with the K2 whilst using it as a variable ND. It's a shame that Freewell don't have a mist diffusion base for the K2 like their magnetic VND system does. I thought it was a really cool idea. Instead, they have numerous different diffusion drop-in filters for their island, as they call it. Various strengths of their glow and snow filters. The glow is warmer, and the snow is cooler. I'm sure you guessed that bit. The problem is the island can only have one inhabitant at a time, so if you wanted to use a grad ND alongside a diffusion filter, you can't unless you hold it out in front of the lens, which I did for a few shots. With streak filters, that's not a good idea. You can of course put your own diffusion filters behind the K2 system, and I did this at times using my soon-to-be-released Bloom Gold filters, which are really good, but I am biased. The K2 island slot system is really nicely done. That rotational ability that I've already shown can be used to change the angle of the grad or the streak filter very easily. There's even a spirit level at the top to make sure you've got it spot on. Until I got the K2, I'd forgotten just how useful graduated ND filters are and how they can really make a big difference with those problematic skies that clip when you try to get exposure right for the rest of the frame. My only real negative about the K2 is that inability to stack combinations of their own filters due to that one slot limitation. I don't know what's possible, but I would love it if they could bring out some magnetic filters to snap on the front. I tried it with some from another brand and they worked fine. Snap-on diffusion filters would let you be able to use them with drop-in graduated NDs or the streak filters. I would also love to see some fixed strength ND magnetic snap-on filters. They do have fixed strength ones which go into the base, but these are not polarisers, so you lose the ability to have a variable ND when using them. There have been times when 9 stops of variable ND hasn't been enough, rarely in England. But in Skiathos, with super bright days on the beach for example, where an extra 3 stops could come in handy. But the more likely scenario is when I'm filming outside and the amount of light control I need could be between, say, 4 and 7 stops, falling right in the middle of the two filters. A 3-stop fixed ND snapped onto the front at a 1-5 would solve this, although perhaps this would affect the colour shift slightly. You can't stack the two different strength variable ND filters as the magnetic polarisation won't let you. Colour shift when you add heavy ND, even with fixed ones, is a common problem. Most times you won't notice it, but it's skin tones that generally are the giveaway. Cat fur, not so much. That's why I always recommend filming a few seconds of an X-Rite colour checker passport as a reference. In fact, I recommend this for whenever you're shooting, when light changes, or using different filters. Even the amazing internal electronic variable ND of the Sony FX6 has a slight colour shift. You just can't see it, as the camera knows it's there and compensates for it. Unless you are shooting ProRes RAW, even then it's very minor. The older dual CPL variable ND options that Freewell have are still very good. They're also more compact. They're still worth considering, and especially the basic split range if you are on a tight budget, as they're a bargain. You just don't get the wonderful true colour from these that the K2 gives you. And it's this that is the thing that has truly impressed me the most, with that ability to rotate the base so I can dial out any unwanted polarisation. This makes it the best variable ND I've used. Oh, and you get this really nice case with it too.
Unlocked. Oh, lovely. What is it then? Prony. Oh, my favourite. Very prony, isn't it?
Is that nice prony?
Fine.
Thank you.